Good evening.
Oh, you can do better than that. Good evening. Hey, thank you for being here. On behalf of President Gilmore and Provost Reed, welcome to the Pennsylvania College of Technology Fall 2019 Colloquium entitled Energy 101. The Penn College Colloquia Series honors Daniel J. Doyle, a professor emeritus of the college's, and the college's 1984 master teacher. And it features presentations by noted authors and academics who challenge their audiences to consider the impact of technology on our society. I'm Paul Starkey, and I'm very pleased to be here as your host. I serve on the faculty, but also on the Colloquia Series Committee. And I've been asked to introduce our speaker this evening, and I'm honored and delighted to do so. I'm doubly pleased to again partner with Bill Hodrick and Nancy Dorman in the Notre Dame Club of Greater Williamsport with a wonderful collaborative opportunity through the University of Notre Dame's Hesburgh Lecture Series. I'd like to tell you a little bit about that series. The Reverend Theodore M. Hesburgh, CSC, or Father Ted, as he was known to those at Notre Dame, not only served as the university's president from 1952 to 1987, but also led it in a transformation from a little Catholic football school in the Midwest to a globally recognized research university it is today. Father Ted is widely acknowledged as the architect of the Civil Rights Act in 1964, and his public service ranged from 14 years with the International Atomic Energy Agency to chairman of the Rockefeller Foundation. From helping craft U.S. immigration and refugee policy to crafting UN human rights efforts, from opposing the spread of nuclear weapons to negotiating Israeli-Palestinian tensions and promoting democracy in Latin America. He was an advisor and an envoy for presidents and popes, but stood up to both. He was the only priest ever to serve as a governor at Harvard University, and he received over 150 honorary degrees before his passing in 2015 at age 97. Father Ted credited a sign during his 1943 ordination as a Holy Cross priest as the inspiration for his remarkable life. It was a literal sign. It's these four words, a touchstone for any Notre Dame alumnus, and the title of Father Ted's biography. It's inscribed on the door lintel at the Basilica of the Sacred Heart. God, country, Notre Dame. Inspired by his example of lifelong learning, the Hesburgh Lecture Series showcases the depth and breadth of Notre Dame's academic experience in research and teaching, and it furthers the university's mission to provide meaningful continuing education opportunities to Notre Dame alumni and friends and community members, and as tonight, partners like the Pennsylvania College of Technology. Together, the partnership of the Notre Dame Club of Greater Williamsport and Penn College secured tonight's speaker, given that the topic is so particularly relevant to our region. Dr. Edward J. Maginn received his Bachelor of Science in Chemical Engineering from the Iowa State University and a PhD in Chemical Engineering from the University of Cal Berkeley. Prior to attending graduate school, he worked as a process engineer, which is pretty important to those of us who teach at Penn College who appreciate some real life experience. He worked as a process engineer for Procter & Gamble, and since 1995, he's been on the Notre Dame faculty and currently holds the Dorini Family Chair of Energy Studies in the Department of Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering. Dr. Maginn's been the recipient of a number of awards, including the Early Career Award for the Computational Molecular Science and Engineering Forum of the American Institute of Chemical Engineers, and the ASEE Dow Outstanding New Faculty Award, the BP College of Engineering Outstanding Teacher Award, and the NSF Career Award. He's a fellow of the American Association of Advancement of Science and the American Institute of Chemical Engineers. In addition, he serves as a trustee of the CHCE Corporation, a nonprofit that develops computer-based educational materials for chemical engineering education. Dr. Maginn's research focuses on thermodynamic and transport properties of materials, with special emphasis on ionic systems important to energy storage and use. And you'll have an opportunity to hear his thoughts on those topics. So please join me in welcoming, in a warm Williamsport welcome, to Dr. Edward J. Maginn.
Well, what a warm introduction and what a great time I've had visiting here. I really want to thank everyone for coming out this evening to listen to a topic that I think is very important. Really had a great visit while I'm here and was really impressed with this university, with this college. The facilities, the students I met, the staff and faculty I met, really great stuff here. Really kind of blown away at the facilities. I wish we had half the facilities you have in these labs that I saw today. So congratulations on being here. So I'll tell you about energy. First, I want to thank you and thank the Greater Williamsport Notre Dame Club, the college, and Patrick Marty and Paul Starkey, who hosted me. And as you heard, this is a picture of Father Hesburgh. He really was an inspiration to those of us at Notre Dame, really kind of put the university on the map. And so out of the generosity of alums, we're able to travel around the country and give these type of talks. So I've been told that you should only give a talk and have three key points. So I'm going to have six key points tonight. We'll see what happens, okay? I think this is a pretty clever audience, and so I think we'll be able to do this. I want you to just take six takeaways from this talk, okay? And we'll go through each one of these in order. The first one will take the longest, and then the other ones will be a little bit faster. But I want to first start us off and give us all the same type of vocabulary. So we'll do some basic definitions, talk about some magnitudes that are involved when we talk about energy, so we all are on the same page. And then we'll talk about where our energy comes from and how much we use. We'll talk about how much energy we have available to us in the future. What's the impacts of our current energy use patterns? What's up with renewables? And then we'll finish by talking about energy research and maybe some of the future and the outlook. And then I hope we have time to engage in dialogue and discussion throughout this. I've given this talk a few times, and I often get lots and lots of dialogue, lots of people asking questions, and I hope we have that again tonight, okay? So let's start with some basic definitions, and I know somebody can answer this question in the audience, so audience participation is helpful. What's the definition of energy? There's a physics class here. I know you guys can answer this question, right? What's the, there's a formal definition of energy. What is it? Do you remember? Are you guys a little bit shy still? Yes?
Specifically of heat or energy in general?
Well, there's a formal definition of what we would call energy. And
the capacity to do work.
Yes, the capacity to do work. That's exactly right.
Well, I'm a physicist.
Okay, that's good. So the physicist got it right. So energy is just the capacity to do work. And what is work? Well, work is the ability to move an object against an opposing force. So a simple way of thinking about what energy is, it's the capacity to do something, okay? Without energy, we can't do anything. We can't live, we can't breathe, we can't move. So we have to have energy if we want to do something, okay? So that's a simple definition that we want to keep in the back of our mind. Now, we're going to talk about, so I have some definitions, so hold on with me here. Primary energy sources. When we say primary energy, it means this is where I can derive that energy and I can do work. And there are two types that I'd like to discuss tonight. The first is non-renewable. So what are those? Well, that's things like oil, coal, natural gas, the three fossil fuels, and then I'll lump nuclear energy in there as well. It's not renewable, but it's not really a fossil fuel. And then there are renewable or solar-driven primary energy sources, photons, wind, hydro, biomass. Okay? Now, all these fossil fuels ultimately came from the sun, but they just came a long time ago. And that's why we call them fossil fuels. So we just reduced a bunch of carbon, buried them in the ground, and now we've been pulling them out of the ground and oxidizing them. Importantly, things like electricity and hydrogen are not primary energy sources because you have to make those. You don't just pull electricity out of the ground. So we have to make them. They're energy carriers, but they're not primary energy. Okay, so when we talk about primary energy, that's what we mean here. Okay? Make sense? All right. So I have to show you pictures of my kids now. So, and these are Notre Dame pictures, so it's a alumni association thing. So this is my daughter, Grace, when she was a freshman playing flag football, and their team won the championship. They got to play in the Notre Dame Stadium, and she scored both touchdowns, and they won the game. So I'm really proud of Grace. Grace is a bioengine. So what is she doing here? She's taken chemical energy and added oxygen, and she can do work and releases heat, carbon dioxide, and water. Okay, so animals, humans, we're simply just bioengines, and we derive our fuel from food. It's exactly the same kind of thing that you see in a car, except we use gasoline, we have a mechanical engine, and we still produce work, heat, CO2, and water. This is a picture of the Notre Dame power plant. We now no longer have coal. As of 2 weeks ago, they stopped all burning of coal, so now there's just natural gas. But this is an old picture where there's a coal pile. And you can take that, and you can put that in a boiler, make steam, run it through a turbine to produce work, and then there's a number one sign that lights up on the top of a building on Notre Dame's campus whenever an athletic team is number one. After this week's football game, this has been taken down, but anyway, this is just another type of an engine. It's called a Rankine cycle, but this is how power plants work, okay? Same exact idea. All we're doing is taking chemical energy, converting it into, in this case, steam. We can produce work, and we can turn that into electricity. You can do that with wind, natural fluxes of wind caused by the sun. You can capture that with a turbine. You can still power things. Or you can do this with radiant energy, the sun. This is a picture on top of Stinson-Remick Hall. This is some of our chemical engineering students. Solar panels, those can take photons and convert that to electricity. Or you could take radiant energy from the sun, add CO2 and water, and you can make plants, okay? This is how fossil fuels were made. All these plants lived and died and were reduced, and now that forms oil, coal, natural gas, etc. Then you can reverse this process, add oxygen, and burn this in a Rankine cycle, and you can make electricity, okay? So these are all the ways that we use primary energy to get the work we want, electricity, motive power, things like that, okay? So that's how we use energy. Now, it's really important when we talk about energy to understand that this is a big, big thing. The magnitude of the numbers are really hard to even wrap your head around. So a watt is a joule per second, a unit of energy per time. So we call that power, okay? And you're pretty familiar with a light bulb, maybe is around 60 watts, right? So that's kind of the order of magnitude about a light bulb. A hairdryer is maybe 1,000 watts. When you start getting up into 1,000,000 watts or 1 megawatt, that's starting to be like jet engines and automobile engines and trucks. If you add 1,000 more of these, that's a city. This is a picture of Mexico City. That's 10^9 watts or 1 gigawatt. And you add 1,000 of these cities and you're 10^12, that's 1 terawatt. So the planet, the magnitude of the energy or the power, this is power, of what we use as a planet is on the order of terawatts, okay? That's a lot of watts, right? But that's the kind of magnitude we have to think about when we're talking about energy. Okay, so here's a first audience interactive part. So I wanna ask you about personal energy use. And I like to use this as an analogy because I think it makes sense. Let's think of units of energy as logs. So one log like this, there's a lot of wood here in Pennsylvania, I noticed flying over. There's a lot of forest. 24,500 BTUs or 7.5 kilowatt hours, okay? So that's one log of energy. If you take 1 gallon of gasoline, that's 5 logs, okay? So this is equivalent, 1 gallon of gasoline is 5 logs. So you just multiply this by 5. Or if you take 13,000 AA batteries or 4,000 of your smartphone batteries, that's equivalent of 1 gallon of gasoline. That's pretty impressive if you think about it. 4,000 iPhones is 1 gallon of gasoline, okay? So, how many logs do you use in a day? So we're gonna take a poll and see how we can get. So, who wants to be brave enough to shout out how many logs they think the average American uses in a day?
45.
200. 1,000. I feel like I should be like one of these. Do I hear 1,000? 2,000, 2,000, 3,000. So 45, 200, 1,000. Anybody want to go less? 1,500 logs a day? Remember, 5 logs is a gallon of gasoline, so you think you're using 300 gallons of gasoline a day. That would cost about what? $900 a day? Probably we're not using that much, right? So what do you think? It's a little bit lower, I think. 30, 10, okay. Let's see, let's count them up. So you can break these down into your household use, so hot water, electricity, air conditioning, 7 logs, roughly. Your personal transport, about 6 logs. Commercial transport, you had to have that thing from Amazon, right? So 4 logs. Commercial buildings, if you're working at a company, companies are providing services for you, that's another 6. People make stuff for you, like food, clothing, that's 11 logs. So it's actually 34 logs. So somebody said 40 logs. That was a really good guess, okay?
So, food?
Yeah. So this is all told, if you add up all of the energy per day that the average American consumes, it's about 7 gallons of gas, $21, okay? And that seems about right. Good thing we're not burning logs. We can burn gas because this would we'd quickly deforest everything, okay? So that just gives you a sense about how much we use as a person. Worldwide, however, we're using about 4 times as much as everybody else on average. So the worldwide per capita is more like 8 logs. So the United States per capita, we use more energy, and I'll come back to that in a minute. Okay, so again, just baseline. I just want to give people a sense of what's going on here. All right, so now add up all the people in the world, and let's ask the question, how much energy do we use, and who is using it all? So this is a really tough plot, so I'm going to show a few of these graphs, and I'll kind of walk you through it. This is something called billions of tons of oil equivalent. So what you do is you take every source of primary energy, you lump it all in, you calculate how much energy that is, and you say, well, if that was a ton of oil equivalent, this is how much it would be, okay? So it's sometimes it might be gas, sometimes it might be coal, but let's just pretend it's all oil. And so this is billions of tons of oil equivalent, okay? And this is by year, starting in 1990. And then here we are right now, and this is a projection that BP has made. The IEA and others have made similar projections. They vary a little bit, but this is pretty much what people are assuming is gonna happen into the future. So here we are currently using 14 billion tons of oil equivalent, which is equivalent to 4.5 trillion gallons of gasoline a year. Okay, so to give you a sense of what that would look like, that's about 4 cubic miles of gasoline. So imagine a big tank, 1.6 miles by 1.6 miles by 1.6 miles, fill that up with gasoline, and boom, that gets burned every year, okay, in the world. So that's equivalent to 18.5 terawatts of power. And the projections are that we're gonna go up in about 20 years to about 24 terawatts because of growth.
Can you spell what's the OECD?
Sure, yeah, I'll go through this. So this is the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development. This is basically the Western wealthy countries. This is United States, Europe, Australia, Japan, South Korea. And what you can see here is that they consume the most energy, but it's flat. In fact, it's dropping a little bit. Blue, China, growing, India, growing, Africa, growing, other Asia, growing, other parts of the world, growing, okay? And the kind of wealthy nations are pretty much flat. So that's what we were projecting, that's what we're kind of seeing now, that's where the energy is being used, okay? Now, why is it growing? Well, there's really 2 things. It's being driven by, so this is again, this billions of tons of oil equivalent versus time. Here's 2017. If you think about what will happen in 2040, well, there are gonna be more people. More people means more energy, so it goes up. A bigger contributor is GDP per head, the affluence of the people. We're getting more wealthy, and we know that as people become more affluent, they consume more energy. That's why the United States consumes more energy than a lot of other countries, because we're more affluent, okay? So you add those two up, and we're way up here, but energy intensity or energy efficiency causes this to drop. So we're becoming more efficient all the time in how we use our energy. So the net increase is not gonna be nearly as big as it would be if we didn't have this energy efficiency. So remember, economic development and growth and population growth are driving increases in energy. Energy efficiency is trying to keep that down. And virtually all of this growth is coming from developing countries. China and India are 50% of that growth rate. It's not happening here. It's happening elsewhere. Okay? All right. Now, I'd mentioned energy is necessary for human development. And you can see that on this plot here. This is from the United Nations Human Development Index. A value of 1 means perfect. And this index measures all kinds of things, like access to health care and education, life expectancy, infant mortality rates, all the things that we would like human beings to have, a good life, like what we typically have in the United States. We're way up here. We're close to 1. We're very good in terms of our human development index. Other countries don't do so well. When you plot this, though, this is showing you the energy use per capita, and it's just remarkable. As an engineer, I love straight lines like this. This is a logarithmic scale. But what it shows you is that there's a very strong correlation between how much energy you consume as a society and how well your people are doing. Okay? And there's variations here. You can do better or worse. But it's very hard to get off of this graph here. And that's why we think that as more and more people emerge out of poverty, 1.3 billion people today don't even have access to electricity. I just got an email from a person in California, and she said, as soon as PG&E stops messing with me, I'm going to, you know, do something, because they turned her electricity off for 2 days. And, you know, it's like, that's a big deal to have your electricity off for 2 days. But, you know, what if you never had electricity? You know, how different would your life be from what you have now? So this correlation means that as we bring people out of poverty, as we allow them to not have to use dung to cook their food and develop cancer, we're going to need to have more energy. And that's why these projections are showing it going up. Okay? All right. The other thing I want to drive home, and then we're almost done with the first part, and this is the hardest, the first part's the hardest part, it has the most stuff. You have to also ask the question is, where are all the people? And this plot kind of really hit home to me. It's very visual, because I think of the United States as sort of pretty much that's everything, right? I think we all tend to do that. But we're really pretty insignificant when it comes to the worldwide population. North America is small potatoes. Here's where all the people live, and here's where they're going to live in 2040. So right now, 60% of the world's population lives in Asia. It's going to be about that in 2050. In North America, only about 4.5% of the people. Okay? So if, as you think about this, emerging economies with lots and lots of people is where all the energy growth is going to come, then this is where we have to pay attention. Asia, Africa. North America is not going to play a huge role in this, in terms of just the raw number of people, I would argue. Okay? So that's one other data point I want you to think about. And the last thing then I'll mention is, this is from the Brookings Institution. So these different organizations have different projections. But what they're saying is, look, lots more people are going to become middle class. Maybe 5 billion people will become middle class. Where? In India, in China, in Brazil, in Mexico. We already have in the OECD, these countries in blue, they're already middle class. That doesn't change. But what does change is all these people get access to middle class wealth, and they want to consume energy to do that. Okay? So here's my first takeaway. Remember, I said there are 6, but this was the longest one by far. I want you to just remember a few things. Big numbers. Energy is a huge endeavor. Right? This is not some small industry. This is tremendous numbers. Terawatts are big numbers. The projections are that power consumption is going to increase by over 5 terawatts in the next 20 years. And that's due to population and GDP growth. Even though we're getting more efficient, these things are overwhelming that, so we're still increasing this. And most of that growth is coming in developing nations. That's a good thing, that we're getting people out of poverty. Human development's a good thing. But that real action is going to be in Asia and Africa, not in North America and Europe, I would argue. Okay? All right, so where does our energy come from? Well, here's another one of these plots again, this sort of billions of tons of oil equivalent. versus year. And now we've broken it down into the types of these primary energy sources we mentioned. So green is oil, red is gas, this black is coal, yellow is nuclear, here's hydro, and here's renewables. And here we are right now, and this is projections. If you look at the shares of primary energy, maybe it's a little easier to see this. Oil is dropping from 50% down to maybe 30%. Coal is sort of plateauing. Gas is going up. Nuclear is kind of up and down. And then renewables are going up. And then these projections are basically just people take a straight line and hope for the best. And that's what we don't know what's really going to happen. But you would guess that maybe gas passes coal in the near future, and renewables continue to increase very strongly. Interestingly, all of these are going up. The fraction, the mix of them is just changing here, okay? So the thing that kind of jumps out at me when I look at this plot is that changes in energy use patterns take a long time. This doesn't happen overnight. This is 1970 through today, okay? So things are not changing dramatically here. And fossil fuels are dominant, okay? 80% is fossil fuels. Even though we're seeing rapid growth in renewables, it's starting from such a small number that it has to take a long time for it to catch up, okay? This plot, this is just kind of for fun. I like to show this graph, it's the most complicated thing. So don't expect to look at this too carefully, but this is it's quite old now, it's back from 2012, but I like this plot a lot. This shows all these different primary energy sources, and then where does it go? And the thickness of these lines tells you how much it is. So let's just look at petroleum, this big fat green line. Most of it goes to transportation, and then some of it goes into industrial use, okay? When it's used in transportation, 26.7 quads, this is a unit of energy, you get 5.6 of those goes into actual moving your car, your truck, and 21.1 units goes into wasted heat because it's an inefficient engine. So look up here at, let's look at coal. The fat black one goes up mostly to electricity generation, 38.1 units. So now the physics guys, you know about the second law of thermodynamics. We only get 12.4 units of electricity out of it, 25.7 units of wasted heat because the second law says that's the way it is. And you can't do any better than that. So you can kind of see where all this stuff goes, and the thickness of the lines is the amount. Natural gas is going all over the place. But the thing that's, you know, looking is kind of solar is really thin line. Wind is still kind of thin. Geothermal is still kind of thin. It's really dominated by petroleum, coal, and natural gas. And then nuclear is a little bit significant here as well, too. All right, so number two takeaway. Fossil fuels are the dominant energy source right now, 80%. We think there's going to be strong growth in renewables. We'll talk more about that later. But it takes a long time to make these changes. And so we just argued at the first part that we need 5 terawatts of additional power in the next 20 years, mostly in the developing world. And my question to you is, how are we going to do that? Where's that going to come from? Okay? And that's what one of the big questions we have to answer, I think, as a world. So let's look at, well, where's the energy now? So let's look at energy reserves. I was asked at lunch about this today. Let me see, does this work? Is there such a thing as peak oil? And I would say, no, there isn't. I don't believe in peak oil because these plots show this is proved oil reserve. They know that this much exists. Starting back in 1980 up until 2015, this is trillion barrels of oil. It just continues to increase. These are the technically recoverable resources in different regions. This is how much we would demand all the way through 2050. And we're not even halfway there, okay? So for every barrel of oil that's been consumed over the last 35 years, we've found 2 more, okay? So I don't think we're gonna see any peak oil anytime soon. There's plenty of oil throughout the world, okay? Yes? Okay, so peak oil is a term that people started using back in actually in the 1970s and 80s. And they said, we're going to reach a point where we're going to use up all the oil, we're going to run out, and all of a sudden it's going to crash, and we're not going to have nearly enough oil. We're going to be using it faster than we can produce it. And it's going to reach a peak, and then it's going to fall off of a cliff, and we're all going to be in big trouble. And what I would argue here is I don't think that that's the case at all. I think the technology of how you find oil has continued to outpace any rates at which we're not able to find it. And so for the foreseeable future, if we want to, there will be oil. The problem is, for the United States, is where is that oil? And it's often in places that, except for our friends in Canada, maybe are a little unstable, maybe we have some political issues with, right? So there's some troubles there. The United States has some oil, but not a ton. Russia has more. But people in this part of the country know that there's something else out there, right? There's shale gas. So here you are in the Marcellus region, very rich, but there's all these different shale plays all over the United States. And when you add in the natural gas, here's what it looks like. The United States, North America, has a lot of natural gas. So does the Middle East and Russia. Based on current projections, I showed you these use patterns, about 200 years of natural gas we have right now, just knowing what we have right now, if we want to use it at the same rates that we're using it. Okay, and then last is this. This is a picture of a strip mine in Wyoming. So there's a guy in an SUV. This is just, you just take this and just dig it and put it in a rail car, and there it is. So that's coal. We have so much coal, it's unbelievable. So we are the Saudi Arabia of fossil fuels, the United States is. If you add the coal reserves, remember these billions of tons of oil equivalent? Here we are, we're at 1,200 billion tons of oil equivalent if we wanted to use the coal. So a lot of coal in the United States. Same in Russia. I would argue here that we have enormous reserves of fossil fuels. We are not going to run out of fossil fuels anytime soon if we want to use fossil fuels, okay? It's all over the world. We are joking. We're going to run out of oxygen before we run out of fossil fuels, I think, right? So that's the third takeaway I'd like to leave with you tonight, is that we have vast amounts of fossil fuels, and if we needed to, we could meet the future energy needs of the world with fossil fuels, but it would not be easy, because 5 terawatts is an awful lot of power. Over 20 years, that means I need to build 5,000 1-gigawatt power plants over 20 years. That's one plant every 2 days for 20 years. 1 gigawatt power plant every 2 days for 20 years, and I just can keep up with the demand. So that's really hard to do. And if you did it, you'd do it with fossil fuels right now because that's what's available, right? And that's what people are doing in China and India. They're using fossil fuels. Okay, so what happens if we keep using fossil fuels? Well, what's the impact? Well, you know what the impact is. I was in China not too long ago, and it really does look like that. And they said it was foggy that day. And I said, that's not fog, that's smog. That's, you know, you're choking on this. So the air quality in China is really bad. That's mostly due to particulates and sulfur from burning coal. But we also know that CO2 concentrations have steadily risen as a result of burning fossil fuels. So those two things are issues that we have to face if we're going to use fossil fuels. And I want to show you a little animation here. This is from NOAA. So if you want, I'll make this presentation available to everyone, but you can go to this and see what this little movie looks like. Before we start it, I want to just explain to you what this is showing. This is showing atmospheric CO2 concentration in parts per million at different locations on the planet. Here's the South Pole. Here's the North Pole. So this is the Northern Hemisphere. And there are different monitoring stations. Here's Mauna Loa in Hawaii. And then different monitoring stations have been put online over the course of time. And it's going to show you an animation of what these different monitoring stations have recorded starting from 1979 up until the present. So can we start the video? So what you'll see is this clock here is moving. Now we're in 1980, and these are different seasons, and this is going up and down. Why is this going up and down? What's happening there? The seasons, right? So in the summertime, the plants are all absorbing the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. It drops. In the wintertime, they all fall off, they rot, and they release the CO2. So it goes back up and down. We don't see very big changes in the South Pole because there's not much plant life down there, right? So what you see here is these sort of up and down, More monitoring stations are coming online and offline, and those points are all just shown here. We're now in 1991. This inset over here shows you the seasonal variation, up and down, and the running average is shown in blue. Okay, so 1989, Mauna Loa saw the last time 350 parts per million CO2 was in the atmosphere. It's gone above that every year since then. And these fluctuations start getting pretty large. The atmosphere is not a well-mixed system, but they're all pretty consistent with one another, okay? And so this just keeps going up, steadily rising. You can see each year. So this is very clear. I mean, we teach a class, the very first class in chemical engineering we teach is called mass balances. This is a mass balance, right? We're taking sequestered carbon out of the ground, we're combining it with oxygen, and we're releasing it into the atmosphere, and the CO2 concentration is going up. So nobody really can argue that this is not happening. I mean, the big question, and I'm not going to get into this, I'm not a climate scientist, but what's this going to mean for us in terms of temperatures and oceans and things like that? That's a big question that is not something I want to talk about, but clearly, we're changing the composition of the Earth's atmosphere, which, you know, might want to give you pause. You want to think about that. Is that really something that we want to live with, or will we be able to live with that? So here you can see we're up over 400 parts per million now. The data going back is not quite as accurate. It goes back to 1958. So this goes back in time, and you see that back in the 50s, we were down around 300 or so parts per million. And then the data gets a little bit even sketchier. So this comes from La Dome ice cores, where they're trying to measure CO2 concentrations. This is a little bit harder to piece together, but you can go back in time. You know, here's Columbus, here's the birth of Christ. The estimates are that pre-industrial CO2 levels were 278, and now we're about 400. So there was a very sharp increase here. And we can pause this. This goes back in time. I don't know how accurate some of this is. So maybe we can stop, or I'll stop it. But the point is that the concentration of CO2 has increased dramatically just in my lifetime. And it's all because we're burning fossil fuels. So you may have heard of the Paris Agreement. The Paris Agreement was designed so that by 2050, we would stabilize the Earth's CO2 concentration level at 450 parts per million. It's at 400 now, give or take. And to do that, you had to reduce the emissions from next year is the last year we can have more CO2, 40 gigatons of CO2 per year. And it has to drop and be cut in half every decade after that. It goes down to 20, 10, and then 5. Land use. We have to remove any CO2 emissions from our land use patterns. We have to actively start removing CO2 from the atmosphere somehow and get 5 gigatons of carbon out of the atmosphere so that in 2050, we're net zero and we reach a plateau of 450 parts per million and we stabilize at that. That's what the Paris Agreement asked people to do. What that means is we're going to have to figure out technologies and politics to do all this. And let me remind you that it's not just like the United States is the only place where we're emitting CO2. This is CO2 emissions over all these different countries. China's the number one emitter. Places like India and Indonesia are big countries that don't emit much CO2, but that are going to grow. So we have to figure out how to get all of these countries working together to meet this problem. And that's a big challenge, I think. So number four takeaway, if we want to stabilize atmospheric CO2 levels at 450 parts per million, we have to bring online 20 terawatts of carbon-free power over 30 years. And I don't think we know how to do that right now. We have to change the way we use the land and start actively capturing atmospheric CO2. And remember again, most of the growth in power use is not here. This is not a US problem strictly, it's a global problem. Okay, so obviously renewables would offer the solution to this, right? Because it doesn't result in CO2 emissions. So what's up with renewables? Well, here's good news, okay? I like this picture. Here's the Earth and here's the sun. Just keep yourself in perspective, right? So there's 120,000 terawatts of solar radiation hitting the Earth's surface, and we only need 20 of those. So technically, we ought to be able to figure out how to do this, right? It's hard to do, though, because this is very diffuse energy, It's intermittent and it's hard to store. So there's a lot of practical reasons. And the people in this room are being trained at this college are the people with the know-how that's going to be able to help fix and correct some of these technologies, okay? And that's really important. So we have to figure out how to solve this problem. Nature concentrated solar energy over a long time in fossil fuels. We have to figure out how could we concentrate energy from the sun today in real time, okay? So let me just give you a couple numbers here again. This is a similar plot. This is the share of the amount of renewables, the share of renewables in terms of percentage for wind, solar, and geothermal. So it's been growing, and the projections are we could get up to maybe 30% in 20 years, but that's probably not enough to solve this CO2 problem that we have. In the European Union, they're projecting over half of their energy will come from renewables. The United States, a little over 30%. But we need to change this curve and make this go up, okay? And that depends on some new technologies. It depends on maybe assigning a cost to carbon dioxide, if we could do that. So let me give you another quick set of calculations as to why this is such a hard problem. I like this example here. So if you know, when we say calories in food, it's actually kilocalories, right? You knew that. So it's 1,000 calories. So if you plot something called the energy density, it's how much energy per pound of stuff you have, you can get numbers that tell you something about how efficient a given thing is at storing energy. So the really nice lithium-ion batteries in your laptop have 50 kilocalories per pound. So if we give that a value of 1, that's a reference value. So your lead-acid battery in your car is much less energy dense. It's about 28% as good as a lithium-ion battery. And alkaline batteries are about 86%. Okay, so this is really pretty good. And you start thinking, well, 50 kilocalories per pound, that's actually pretty good, right? Until I show you like the lowly Oreo double stuff is 43.9 times the lithium-ion battery, okay? So cookies are a really good way of storing energy, and you know that, right? Because when you eat them, it releases the energy, doesn't it? Here's wood, coal, gasoline's 100 times more energy dense than your lithium-ion battery. Methane, hydrogen, and then uranium is 2 × 10⁸, okay? So here's the thing. Nature figured this out. Nature figured out if you want to store energy, you don't put lithium ions and intercalate them into a carbon and cobalt matrix and have this membrane separator and an aqueous electrolyte or whatever. You just make you make carbon and hydrogen bonds. You make covalent bonds, and that's how you store energy. And so this energy storage thing is a real deal if we're going to make renewables work. And that's a big problem because when I can store 100 times more energy per pound in gasoline than I can in a battery, think about making a car run on the same type of situation. You need 100 times the fuel, if you will, to make a lithium-ion battery car work. Here's another little calculation we give to our freshmen. We ask them to calculate the power transfer rate when you fill up your car with gasoline. So if you just do the numbers, it's 2 gallons a minute, that's 4.2 megawatts. So those offshore wind turbines produce about 5 megawatts of power. So when you're just filling up your car at the gas station, you're powering, it's the equivalent of powering 1,000 homes with that transfer rate of gasoline. It's a tremendous rate of energy transfer. And that's why this is a very hard thing to beat. Fossil fuels are tough to beat. One of the questions that people have asked me is, they say, well, if I have an electric car, is that good for the environment? And I tell them it depends. And here's why. This is a plot that shows the grams of CO2 released per kilometer of driving distance. These dashed lines are gasoline cars. They're from 200 to 260 grams of CO2 per kilometer, depending on how efficient they are. If you have an electric car, and your electricity comes from coal, you're actually doing worse than a gasoline-powered car. Remember I showed you that second law of thermodynamics. You take coal, you make electricity, you had to burn a lot of coal to make a little bit of electricity, you transmit it then, you put it in a battery, you do blah, 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 and then you drive your electric car and you're actually releasing more CO2 because where you got your CO2 or your electricity from. Same is true if you get your electricity from oil. If it's natural gas, you're doing a little bit better, but not as good as you might think. It's only if you have truly renewable energies or nuclear power can you drive this down to close to zero, okay? So we want to be able to use these, but unfortunately, a lot of these are intermittent sources, so it makes it hard to use. This is something that I think, this is in Pennsylvania. A lot of the energy storage in the United States now is pumped hydro. We pump water up at night, and then during the day we let it run down and we recover that power. There's about 23 gigawatts of storage capacity there, and that's 96% of our storage capacity. What we need are ways where it's flat land, like where I'm from, where you don't have this luxury. Can you make things like big flow batteries that can store, say, solar energy during the day and release them at night and modulate this? So if we had ways of doing better energy storage, I think we could start getting to using renewables more efficiently. So this is number 5 of 6, and I'm almost done. I would argue that we have enough solar energy hitting the earth to meet all of our energy needs, but it's a hard problem. It's a technical problem. It's due to this energy density problem. And so we need something to be cheap. We don't have that. We already have cheap fossil fuels, and we also have a huge infrastructure that's already been built to utilize fossil fuels. And what are we going to do with that? And it's a very difficult economically and politically to just throw all that away. So I think technology plays a role, but also obviously policy and the economics of this all have to move together if we're going to make some sort of a transition away from fossil fuels to renewables. That's, I think, the key message that I'd like to leave here. Last piece. So professors always say we need more research. So I'm going to argue we need more research, okay? And here's why. This is industrial spending on research, pharmaceutical industry, the IT industry, and the energy industry. If you look at the percent of revenue that gets spent on research, pharma spends 20% of their revenue on research. I mean, they're plowing money back in all the time trying to develop new drugs. IT, 15%. Energy, 0.23%. Okay, so there's not been a huge investment in the energy industry on R&D. And also, if you look at the total research spending, here's total spending, here's U.S. government spending. On energy, we spend a lot of money, $1.4 trillion. Of that, the government spends about $5.3 billion. But healthcare, the government spends $31 billion. And defense, the government spends $70 billion. Okay? So if you look at these numbers, you say, what do we care about most as a government in terms of R&D? We care about defense and healthcare, and then, yeah, maybe a little bit of energy, okay? But I would argue that maybe we should try to increase this number a little bit because of the things I've been pointing out to you earlier. Quickly, I'll tell you a little bit what Notre Dame's doing. So Notre Dame used to be a heavy focus on arts and letters and humanities. When I started at Notre Dame, 9% of our students were engineers, now 25% of our students are engineers. There's been a huge shift. And a lot of chemical engineers. This is our graduating class of 2017. This is 113 students. So students are very excited. They want to work in the energy industries. They're wanting to get involved in this. And that makes me really happy and optimistic. We have some big centers. This is an energy center. There's been over $50 million in energy-related research carried out there. We just won a National Science Foundation Engineering Research Center that's called C-STAR that's focusing on taking shale gas and using modular processing technologies, converting that to fuels and chemicals in an environmentally benign way, thinking of this as a bridge fuel, natural gas as a bridge fuel till eventually we can get to renewables. I'm involved in an energy storage center that's headquartered at Argonne National Lab. It's called J. Caesar. We're trying to develop things that are beyond lithium-ion batteries. So we've had over $120 million in funding over 5 years. All kinds of startups, all kinds of students trained, almost 400 papers published, lots of stuff going on there. And then two other ones I'll point out. We're also working on a safer nuclear power process, which is based on a totally different technology, molten salt technology. Current nuclear power is sort of 1960s technology. We know that it's not inherently safe because of the need for using cooling water, which can overpressurize and cause problems like we saw in Fukushima. You can do the same thing by using a molten salt as the heat exchange medium. And I won't go into all the details of this, but this is inherently much safer. It allows you to process nuclear waste that we now have to get rid of. You can actually reuse this and get more energy out of it. And you could almost, you could also run this on thorium, where we have almost an unlimited supply of thorium. So we haven't really spent much research dollars on new advances in nuclear power, I would argue, and I think we should. So this is a big collaboration with Notre Dame and a lot of national labs in the University of Iowa that's working on this. And then the last thing I'll just highlight, our electrical engineers are leading a center called LEAST, which is a low energy systems technology. They're working on more efficient electronics. A lot of energy is wasted through just dumb electronics. So this is a huge collaboration with lots of companies and universities that are trying to develop the next generation of electronics. So the last takeaway that I want you to remember is we spend a lot of money on energy research, but we don't spend nearly as much as we do on other things that are, I think, considered a higher priority to us. And maybe we should think about having a conversation about that. Lots of cool stuff's going on at my university and elsewhere, and I think that this is really a cause for optimism. And we need more people and resources to address this global problem. And I hope some of you in the audience, some of you students, really take this to heart. I saw a lot of really cool stuff in the HVAC group and in the automotive group and other places that I toured today. You are the guys who are going to be able to figure this out, right? It's your generation that's going to have to fix this. And I hope that you take your skills that you're learning here and apply this to helping solve some of these problems. So the last thoughts. Energy is a fundamental human right. It's very important to us being able to live a good life. And we all have should have access to it. But that means we're going to consume more energy into the future as more people are lifted out of poverty. I think that there's an enormous amount of fossil fuels that could be used, but utilizing that is leading to changing the atmospheric composition, and that causes some concerns. So what are we going to do? We're going to have to figure out 20 terawatts of carbon-free power over the next 30 years. This is a global moonshot. And I think we can do it. We're up to the challenge, but we have to decide we want to do this. And I just want to know what you think. So I hope we have time for some conversations at the end here. There were some books that were suggested. There's some other books that I would highly recommend if you're really interested in this. The Quest tells energy security and the remaking of the modern world. This book by Richard Mueller from Berkeley, Energy for Future Presidents, it really breaks a lot of the technologies down. Here's Prosperity Without Growth by Tim Jackson. And then Bill Gates, this is online, you can get this. Energy Innovation, Why We Need It and How to Get It. It's a really nice read if you want to take a look at that. Here's my email address. It's pretty simple. It's ed@nd.edu. If you'd like a copy of this presentation, I'll be happy to give you a link where you can download it and take a look at it. You're free to do that, so just shoot me an email and I'd be happy to do that. And if we have time, I'd like to stop there and see if we have some questions or discussion. Thank you.
So we have a couple of folks who are roaming the auditorium with microphones. So if you have a question, raise your hand. They'll come to you, and Dr. Maginn will field your question.
I'll do my best.
From all the takeaways, which one is the most important to you personally?
I think that's a good question. I think it's this one. It's this one. It's that we all know that we're using a lot of fossil fuels. We all know that the atmospheric composition is changing. And we have to believe that we can fix it. I think we have to convince ourselves. I think it's easy to say this problem is just so big, I'm just going to run away from this because we just can't do it. And I would say, no, we can fix this problem. It just means, do we have the will to fix it? And I'd like to kind of raise this as a question that says, look, we do have the ability. We're smart beings. We figured out how to do all these other great technologies. We can figure this problem out too. So I'm optimistic. I'm not going to be pessimistic. I think we can do this, but we have to decide that we want to do it.
I noticed in your second key takeaway, you had hydro separate from renewable resources. Is there a reason that you do not lump hydro with renewables?
That was probably a mistake, because I would say hydro is renewable. So if that was the case, I shouldn't have done that. So yeah, hydro is definitely a renewable resource for sure. The problem with hydro right now is that we've sort of taken all the good dams and places we can do this, and it doesn't scale very well, right? We can't, there's just not a bunch more Hoover dams that we can find. If you try to build a big dam where I live, you're going to flood the entire Midwest, right? So it doesn't really work.
Dr. McGinn.
Yes.
All right. I have a quick question. So you talk about, like, we're racing a lot of fuels. You think in the future, will cars be made by solar, like be chargeable by a solar panel type or anything, or by the sun or not?
Yeah, so the question is, could you have a solar panel on top of your car and just drive around like that?
Yeah, or like something like inside the gas tank that like recharges your car. Like you don't have to get fuel or anything, just drive and go.
Yeah, I mean, you know, plug-in electric vehicles exist now. And, you know, in California, for example, I was out there, my former student teaches at UC Davis, and they have big, you know, awnings where they park all their cars and their solar panels, and then they plug their cars in there. And that works really well in California. Where I live, it's dark and dreary, you know, 90% of the time. That's not going to work very well there. So one of the problems with those sort of localized solutions is it doesn't necessarily translate to every environment. Whereas now, in our current infrastructure, you have a gas station every mile, right? And it's all over the whole country, so you don't have to worry about that. So I think one of the ideas that they have in Israel is you just have drop-in batteries. So you go to a gas station and you just change out your battery and get a new battery, and then they charge them elsewhere. That's a model that they're using there, because the charging time of these batteries is very long. So what you'd like to have is a store of those batteries lying around, and you just go in and, you know, it's like a bottle deposit, basically. So I think there's a lot of cool technologies that are out there that could be done. I don't know all the answers to these things, but I think those kind of, that new thinking and trying to come up with new ways of doing this is what we need, for sure.
When you spoke about...
where is this?
Back here.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You spoke about the cause and effects on the environment between different types of energy, coal, electric, all that. Does your graphs that you've shown take into effect the cost on the environment for mining for batteries and foraging of batteries? Because I've seen research that shows that's just as bad as using gas.
Yeah, that's actually a really good point. And no, I didn't do the full life cycle analysis of what's the whole environmental impact of that. But you're absolutely right. You have to do that type of an accounting. That's why I don't think lithium-ion batteries are going to be able to be scaled to make a huge impact, because there's just not enough lithium in the world to be able to do that, let alone the fact that you have to also have cobalt in these batteries. Mining all that is actually not very good. There's actually a lot of human rights violations in some of these mines where they get this stuff from, and we kind of just don't talk about that. So definitely all of those things are important, which is why I think we need more people paying attention to this and looking for other solutions. These flow batteries that I was talking about, we have a project with the Department of Energy, and we're looking at making a flow battery. Right now they use vanadium, which is not a very good thing to have to use for this. We're looking at using things like, it's called choline chloride, which you find it in chicken feed, as one of the salts that could be used in these redox flow batteries. So looking at earth abundant, cheap, inexpensive things like iron, choline chloride, those kind of things. Those are the kind of questions that we have to start pursuing as well if we're going to do this kind of thing. But it takes a lot more research to be able to do that. Does that help? There's one.
You're in the middle.
Okay.
So you were saying 450 parts per million of carbon in the atmosphere. That's the goal? Like, that's where you want to plateau at?
Well, it's not. That's what the Paris Agreement wants to plateau at. Yeah.
Like, where's the danger zone? Like, how, if we miss that goal, how far up can we get before it's bad?
your guess is as good as mine. I mean, I don't know the answer to that. And, you know, CO2 is a greenhouse gas, there's no doubt about it. And the physics of that is really well understood. It has to do with the vibrational frequencies of infrared versus UV frequencies as it hits the CO2. So it would force the temperature to go up. Now, again, I'm not a climate scientist. I read what you read and I hear what everybody else says, and they say it's going to cause the temperatures to go up. And, you know, they're saying 450 is kind of, if it starts getting much higher than that, we're going to have real problems. I don't know what the answer to that is. There's also the problem of acidification of the oceans. So as you have more CO2, you just know it's basic acid-base chemistry, you're going to acidify the oceans. What's that going to do? Probably not great, right? And so I don't know that we know that there's a safe number. 450 is what they've said is maybe possible. It's pretty aggressive, though. If you just look at what we have to do for 450, that's pretty aggressive. There may be other people who are...
One more question.
We did have one back here, so I'm going to stick with order back and forth here.
Okay.
Okay. What's the viability of hydrogen? What role will it play in fixing this?
Yeah, so hydrogen is not a primary energy source, I mentioned, so you have to make hydrogen. Right now, we make hydrogen from natural gas. So we'll do cracking of a natural gas reforming and make hydrogen. When you do that, you can capture the carbon as a result of that process. It's easier to capture the carbon dioxide at that point, and then you can think about sequestering that. So that's one of the things that people have talked about, is maybe this natural gas boom, what I can do is I can make hydrogen. I could use that hydrogen in, say, a fuel cell to run a car, something like that, and then sequester the carbon dioxide that I create if I do that. So that's a technology that's possible. The problem with hydrogen, of course, is transporting hydrogen is really difficult. It embrittles metals, it leaks everywhere, it's very hard. And you have to compress it an awful lot to get enough hydrogen into a small space. So its energy density is actually pretty low because it's a small mass, right? So there's a lot of technical problems with just using hydrogen as a fuel for that case. But again, I think we should not discard anything at this point. We should, you know, put all these different things on the table and let's see if we can make something work. So
I want to thank you, Dr. Maginn, for your fascinating presentation. I want to thank all of you for coming. We do have an opportunity to continue this conversation. We have a reception downstairs in Rapture, which is down one floor and immediately behind what would be behind the auditorium. And we encourage you to come down and continue this conversation. I want to thank the Colloquia Committee. I want to thank the Greater Williamsport and Notre Dame Club for your participation in helping us, Bill and Nancy, for allowing us to connect with the Hesburgh Lecture Series. And mostly I want to thank Dr. Maginn for a great presentation. Please join me in thanking him.